my name is Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and I've been a professor for over 5 years now. Today, I wanted to talk about a topic that is very near and dear to my heart, and that is finding a thesis topic that you are passionate about. Getting a PhD is a very long and scary process, and working on something that you're not truly in love with can be challenging. Now, I've had a very interesting journey where I've tried many different topics out, so I wanted to give you my candid advice about how you can find a topic that you are passionate about. So let's jump on in. First, let's talk about why you need to be passionate about your PhD topic. The truth is you don't need to be. It will just make your life a lot easier. And I've seen lots of people do this different ways. And I think I'm the most passionate about my topic out of anyone that I know. And what it has helped me do is to create a really long, sustainable path. And that's not just your PhD, but afterwards, studying things that you are interested in helps you have a long career and it helps you with those highs and lows. There's no way around it. There's going to be some emotional parts of your PhD, some exciting parts, and studying something that you really love can help you make it through those more challenging aspects of things like getting rejections or struggling with writing or the mental health challenges that can come along. So I think it is important, but not necessary. I think there's plenty of people that are successful out there that don't really have any passion for their topic at all. They're just dedicated people. And I'll give you some advice as well. If you're a person who you don't really think you have a passion for anything per se, how do you find a topic that is really invigorating to you? So in order to identify a topic that you are passionate about, the first thing you need to do is figure out what your passions are. And I think people tend to get stuck in the type of research that they've done historically and the type of research that they see done out there, and they don't think creatively about connecting something outside of academia to their academic explorations. For example, I love art. I have a background in art, and I didn't think that there was any field for studying art scientifically, so I pursued just doing art as an artist, right? Had I known that I could integrate art with a research passion, I would have absolutely pursued that, but I wasn't that creative. I didn't think you could do that. What I ended up doing is studying visual perception in psychology, and then I learned about data visualization and realized that I could apply my passion for art, visual art, to data visualization, and it gave me an edge because I had a whole background in looking and thinking about visual information that impacted us, right? So what I want you to do is to think about what are your passions. They don't have to be academic, they could be outside. Think about things like, what do you have the most fun doing? When are you the happiest? When do you find yourself enjoying the time that you're spending? What I'd like you to do is to make a list and write down the top 5 times that you have been the most happy. And when you're writing those down, I want you to think about all of the things that were happening in your life that contributed to those happy moments. That might have been you had more time to pursue a hobby, or maybe you got to spend lots of time with loved ones, or you were in some other situation that made you really happy. But what I want you to do is write down that list and then reflect and see if you can find a through line through all of the times that you were the happiest, and try to see if there was some type of topic or area that you found just by being involved in that topic or interest, it made you truly happy. So hopefully you've identified some things that really are central to your happiness. And some of those are just situational, the situation that you put yourself in, like maybe you need a good work-life balance, that type of thing. But if you were able to identify some types of topics, now the trick is to see how you could integrate that into your current research. Now, in order to do that, you need to understand the constraints of your current research. This is the type of stuff that for your field where you find yourself at now, you cannot change. It has to be done in this sort of way. So I want you to create a list of constraints for your particular research area where you find yourself. These include things like maybe there's a certain technique that you have to use. Maybe there's a type of theory that has to be employed. Maybe there's a type of machinery that you need to use. I want you to make an exhaustive list of all of the requirements that your PhD topic and your thesis will need to include. And these need to be the things that you're thinking of, but also from your advisor's standpoint. It might be that you are funded on a grant and it has to be, you know, within the realm of that grant for you to continue your funding. So make a list of all of those hard constraints. Okay, now that you have your hard constraint list, I want you to know that everything that is not on that list is likely changeable or movable. So it could be something where you've identified within your passion, you like working with your community. You really enjoy when you're around the community that you grew up in, okay? So maybe you want to do your research with this community, but that has never been done before. And that might seem like it's impossible to do, but if it's not on your constraint list, it is not impossible. It just hasn't been done before. And that's really where you find the synergy, where it's not as if you can't do it, just no one has done it before. So what I want you to do is to assume if it's not on your hard constraint, you can likely do something new and different and innovative. What that likely means is that you are integrating two things in a way that's probably novel. That might mean that you are excited about, I don't know, classical literature, right? And maybe one of your hard constraints from your PhD advisor is that it has to be only literature before the 1900s, okay? But you're also interested in hip hop. How do you integrate those two things? Well, maybe you can find, you know, the initial predecessors to hip hop and trail that back, and you find a integration of these two fields by doing this. Maybe no one's done it before because it seems unusual, but that doesn't mean you can't do it. If it's not on that hard constraint list, think about it as it is possible, just no one has done it yet. So moving from your constraint list to your passion, you want to find an integration that takes the work that you're doing with your passion and fuses those together. That usually means that you're going to be doing interdisciplinary work, where you're taking two types of fields and combining them. So the next thing that you want to do in that process, now that you've identified this kind of union of two things, is to identify your specific thesis question. And this will help you guide the integration of these two things. So what you're going to want to do is to do a literature review of the current research that you're doing, the type of research, and then you're going to do a literature review of the field that you want to integrate. And you want to identify gaps, because your goal is to create a research question. And what I want you to do for your thesis in particular is to write a research question that is exactly one sentence long. It needs to be scoped enough that you can say it in a single sentence. So what that means is that you're identifying a specific, explicit problem that you can address within one thesis itself. What you don't want to do is have this expansive problem like, we don't know about human consciousness, and I'm going to figure out what human consciousness is in this thesis. No, that's too big. It needs to be a scoped, compact problem that is an integration of these two fields, okay? So what that usually means when you're integrating two things is you tend to find gaps where the literature set A doesn't explore certain aspects that literature source B does, but literature source B doesn't use the methods from the previous, right? So you identify a gap and saying, by integrating these two, I am going to fill a gap, or I'm going to address a problem, or I'm going to solve a currently known problem by integrating these two things. Without these two fields, we couldn't have integrated them before. The trick is to write a one sentence thesis statement problem, and it needs to be phrased as a problem, not just an area of exploration, okay? I know I'm hitting this a little hard, but I really want you to focus on identifying an explicit problem, not just an area, because you will need to address this problem within the thesis. Now, that's not to say that's the only way that people do it, but I think the most successful way that students integrate multiple fields is they identify an explicit problem. So now you need to craft a compelling thesis proposal. Eventually, you're gonna take this and propose it to someone and they will approve it or not, okay? So the way that you're going to do that when you're integrating these fields is you will write up a literature review of research field A and describe the open questions as you go through that, or even summarize those at the end. Do the same thing for research field B, have the open questions at the end, and you say, my thesis is going to address this open question or address this gap or have a solution to this problem by doing X. So you want to have a clear problem and your research is going to solve it by doing something another. Okay, that's how you write something compelling. You identify a new problem, you describe why it's an important problem, why it needs to be addressed, clearly state what that problem is, and say, my work will address it by doing this type of thing. This approach that I'm telling you will help you create a really strong, compelling research proposal that can integrate your passion with your main area of expertise. So that's my advice if you're someone who can identify a research passion, Maybe you don't have a passion, and that is okay. I know plenty of people who are very, very successful, and they'd never had any like strong desire to, you know, focus their research on any one thing. Maybe they don't have a strong passion themselves just inherently, and that is totally fine, okay? For those people, what I've seen is most successful is to do work that they are good at. So you will find that you like things that you're good at. Everyone does, okay? So the way to formulate your research proposal, if you truly cannot identify a passion, is to take your unique skill set and integrate that into the proposal itself. You want to put yourself in a position where your work is going to be as high quality as possible. And so you want to capitalize on the things that you are naturally good at. That means that, say you're someone who's very detail oriented, you want that to be a huge focus of your thesis because there's lots of people who aren't. So yours will be even better because you're capitalizing on your skills. Maybe you're someone who's very creative, so having a creative novel idea is part of that. Maybe you're someone who can learn things very quickly, so having multiple different domains that you're integrating that you had to learn will be a big part of your thesis. So what I'd like you to do, if you're a person who could not identify a passion, is instead to write down a list of 5 times you've been the most successful, and then to look at a through line of those 5 times that you've been the most successful and see what were the conditions that made you successful. Maybe it's working in groups, maybe it's working independently, maybe it's having the time to explore these ideas, maybe you need a lot of structure and you had a job that was 9 to 5 and had all of these regimented steps, okay? Whatever it is, write down your 5 list and find the through line, and you're going to try to understand from that list, what is the thing that makes you the most successful, and have that be a major, major component of your thesis. And then as you're putting your thesis together, you're going to find it to be naturally easier. You're going to capitalize on your skills, and it's going to be very strong and effective for you. And I can hear some of you giving pushback a little bit and saying, you know, my thesis and my PhD is a time to learn. I want to learn things that I'm not good at. Okay, more power to you. But what I've seen consistently across dozens of students like this is they set themselves up with something challenging, uniquely challenging for themselves that might be easier for someone else, and they're fighting that the entire way. It's as if they're having to fight who they are and the things that naturally they're good at, in addition to fighting the PhD. And I'm here to tell you the PhD is hard enough. You don't need to make it harder on yourself, unless you're someone who runs marathons and you like just doing hard things for the sake of them being hard. But I think by and large, people tend to be the most happy when they are doing things that they are good at. And the trick is that you're gonna have some things that make you good at something where another person is not good at that. So you want to use that to give yourself an edge. And then within that, as you've done this process, you will probably start to identify the things that you are not good at. So my piece of advice for that is take the things that you're not good at and try to offload them to some degree. Offload it onto technology. Maybe you're not good at scheduling. So offload that onto a piece of technology that will schedule for you, or bring in collaborators that can support the things that you are not good at, that you're not gonna be as successful at. I hope this was helpful. This has been my guide to finding your passion and integrating this into a successful thesis topic. I truly love what I study for my PhD, and it took me a long time of trial and error to find things that didn't work out for me. What I don't want you to do is have to go through a trial and error process. Instead, to find something early that you like or that works for you, and to take that all the way through, and your life will be so much easier in the end. Thank you so much for watching. If you've enjoyed this video, please click the like button and subscribe for more content on academic success. Take care.